How are you doing? Great, great. Thank you for the kind intro. So today, I wanna talk about a question I've been dealing with for a very long time. How do you explain that we get our best ideas with our backs against the wall? Or better, how do you explain that when we reach a dead end, we all of a sudden see possibilities we didn't see before? Let's look at some examples. In the late 1880s, two struggling comedians wanted to create a new show about how comedians get their materials and write jokes. But very soon, they ran out of ideas and they had no experience in writing for the medium. It was only then, when they reached a roadblock, that they came out with the idea for Seinfeld, which is a show about nothing. What a brilliant concept, a show about nothing. Well, let's look at Samsung. Samsung started out as a noodles company. Did you know that? Noodles. They were selling noodles and dried seafood. It was only after the company assets were buried under the ashes of the Korean War that they reinvented themselves as the electronics company we know today. Southwest Airlines, they were losing money, and they had to sell their aircrafts in order to stay in business. It was at that point, when they were struggling to survive, that they invented the 10-minute turnaround, which enabled them to land, offboard the passengers, prepare the plane, onboard new passengers, and take off in 10 minutes only, which meant more flight time, which meant more money. The Instagram founders, they started out with a completely different product called Bourbon. It was a location-based app. The problem is, users were not checking in at all. Tiny problem. But what users were doing, however, they were just uploading photos like crazy. And this is how they came up with the concept of a photo sharing app. And Kevin Systrom, one of the founders, he said something in one interview that really got my attention, and I brought it to you because it demonstrates my point. He said, "Initially our bet was on location, and frankly, I'm just very happy we discovered the image thing along the way." Now, when we hear stuff like this, most of us say, wow, what a genius. Oh man, he's so lucky that billion-dollar ideas just drop into his head effortlessly. And we focus on discovered. He's a discoverer. What an amazing story. What a lucky man. And the problem with looking at it that way is then we start to think, what do we need to do in order to get just a tiny bit of Kevin Systrom's luck, or a tiny bit of his genius? And we start to do all sorts of things, right? First of all, our first go-to thing is sticky notes. We need sticky notes. Okay, no sticky notes, it means we were not thinking. So we fill the room, floor to ceiling with sticky notes. Then what? What do we do now? Oh, I know. We need to express ourselves. We need to bring some paint, and we need to, out of our own emotions, something will, for sure, some genius or some luck will come. But then it doesn't work either. So we say, okay, we understand the problem. The office is the problem. We need an off-site. We need to get away from the office to be genius and lucky, and then to get back. So what you do is, actually, I've been in an off-site where we took some surfboards and we floated on the river, in the Jordan River in Israel, and we needed to brainstorm during when we were doing it. It's a true story. And guess what? Nothing happened. People just fell in the water all the time. So I think that looking at it that way is missing the point. What got me in this sentence is actually this part: along the way. The actual work you put in along the way. Because if Seinfeld wouldn't have to work and rework their script, they would not come across a concept of a show about nothing. If Samsung wouldn't have to work their way out of a crisis, they would not reinvent themselves as the company we know today. If Southwest Airlines would not work hard to survive, they would not stay in business and come up with the concept of the 10-minute turnaround. And if the Instagram founders would not work so hard to gather the user's feedback, you all know how hard it is, how tiring it is to understand how people are actually using what you designed, then they would probably never think of a photo sharing app. So the work itself is the most powerful mechanism for creativity and for your best self. And it's not only them. 70% of all companies, successful companies today, evolved into their winning products and ideas while they were working. This is research-based, and it's an amazing thing. And if I had to describe with one word and one word only the common conditions they all faced, that would be uncertainty. So the question is this: what if uncertainty is not an obstacle? What if it's an accelerator to help us reach our best brain potential? What if we could control it and trigger it on demand when we work, on our daily tasks? Also, for me and my teams, looking back in retrospective, I find out that the most impactful features I ever delivered were under extreme uncertain conditions and time pressure. So when I realized this, I realized there is something here. I might be onto something. But there is still a problem after we understand that uncertainty is good. Okay, that's good. We still have a very, very big problem. The problem is that every inch of our body, every inch of our mind is fighting for the complete opposite. We want certainty. Our brain wants to conserve energy by repeating what we already know that works. So we just do it over and over again. So what we really need is, we need habits to push us into uncertainty on purpose so that we can get into our best creative ideas. And this is what my book is about. It's called The Other Ideas. And I would like to share with you today three habits that I've chosen from my book to help us trigger uncertainty while we work, because otherwise, we're probably not thinking. So, the first habit I'd like to share with you today is to constrain your superpower. But wait a minute, what's a superpower and how can you constrain it? So a superpower is this thing we all have, something you know how to do even in the middle of the night with your hands tied behind your back. Something you've been doing for years and you've been doing it well, and you've been repeating it over and over again. It's your superpower. It doesn't need to be something big. It can be using a spreadsheet or a certain software, whatever tool you use. The problem is that when I ask most people, when did they do a big leap in this superpower of theirs, they tell me a long time ago. We are afraid to touch it. The thing that we're very good at, we're afraid to touch, because we're repeating what we already know that works. So for example, for me, I've been wireframing for years. How many people here are wireframing? Yeah, I see a lot of, many heads nodding. Okay, so we're all in the same boat. And I've realized that I'm wireframing out of my sleep. Okay, and at that point, I decided to restrict myself to only two or three templates. So if, for example, if I had to wireframe a 50 screen app, I would say, okay, how do I do that with only two or three templates? And even a very experienced wireframer, I used to hold my head and say, oh my God, why did I get into this? So then, all of a sudden, the brain starts thinking. Or, for example, a designer that attended my workshop, his superpower is to create these amazing illustrations, very colorful and vibrant. And following this habit, he called me up and he told me that he decided to use only one color only. He put a restriction on his superpower. And guess what happened? He invented an entire new design language, an entire new animation language out of this constraint. It's amazing. But a superpower doesn't need to be a skill. It can also be a resource. Look at Wikipedia, for example. Their flagship feature, where we can all go in and edit Wikipedia pages, isn't just an idea that came into the CEO's mind effortlessly because he's a lucky genius. It's only because they didn't have money to bring professional editors. So they ran out of money, and they had to engage the community. And this is what brought about the feature that we all know that is the flagship feature, and what differentiates Wikipedia, what gives them the power of the community, of the people, of the globe. So it's a very interesting thing, you see? The relationship between the resources we have and the certainty or uncertainty we need to face is an interesting thing, because the more resources we have, the less uncertainty we need to face, because we have everything under our hand. So since we understand that creativity is inside uncertainty, so what this graph really means is that when resources go down, creativity goes up. And this is what we want to do with this habit. So in one research, a psychological research, they tested and they saw that we only start to think when we encounter something, an obstacle, something we didn't face, something we didn't expect. And it's only then that our brain switches from autopilot to thinking mode. And we want to push ourselves to this direction and to work from there as much time as possible. Before I go into my second habit, anybody know this guy? Miles Davis, yeah, I love him. He's a legendary jazz trumpeter. And in 1959, he recorded an amazing album, a flagship album. It's called Kind of Blue. Let's listen to one piece, and 20 seconds, and then we'll continue. Okay, nice, right? What most people don't know is that the drummer came in too fast and too strong. And what do most musicians do when something goes wrong in the recording? They say, no, no, roll it back. So they say, roll it back. I want it the way I imagined it, the way I wanted it to be. But what Miles Davis did, he just used this drummer's mistake to jump in with an amazing trumpet solo, which came one of the most famous trumpet solos in jazz. Now, let's listen to it again. I'll show you when the drummer comes in. Okay, ready? Right now. Okay. So you see how things got out of sync and into sync again. And I'm telling you this because it leads me to my second habit, which is to adopt a mistake. You know, we all know that same old thinking leads to same old results and ongoing cycle. But every once in a while, when we work, something unexpected happens. And what do we do at that point? What Miles Davis did is not go back to the baseline of what we wanted to do. What we do at this point is instinctively roll back. But what I'm suggesting and what I'm pushing you and urging you to do is to actually take a step back and look at the situation and see, if you couldn't go back, what's the next organic step you could do from this point on? And then you can discover unexpected beauty and unexpected opportunity. So instead of going back, you're bringing up unexpected thinking, which brings more unexpected results. So it's actually, the mistake was not a mistake. It was an opportunity to cross from a certain mindset to an uncertain mindset and open up for creativity. And Pixar understands this. So what they do, they switch their team members as they work on a movie. So the production team keeps changing, because they know that it's so hard for us to adopt new ideas. We all the time stick to what the previous ideas we wanted. So of course we're not Pixar, we can't change the people all the time, but try to think, what you would think about your own work if you were the new team member that's coming in the room, who doesn't know what it's supposed to be. He only knows what it can be. So obviously we can't control things that happened. Unexpected things will happen anyway. But what we can do is to react differently and to make the next natural step from this point on. This will lead us to a road of uncertainty and discovery. Before I go to my third and final habit, you know this guy, anybody watching South Park? Great, great. Let's see a short clip.
Captain Hindsight! Captain Hindsight, thank God you've come!
What's the skinny?
There's people trapped in that burning building, Captain Hindsight, and the fire is so massive we can't get to them! You see those windows on the right side? They should have built fire escapes on those windows for the higher floors, then people could have gotten down. And then on the roof, they should have built it with a more reinforced structure so a helicopter could have landed on it.
Yes, of course!
And then you see that building to the left?
Yes!
They shouldn't have built that there, because now you can't park any fire trucks where you really need to. Well, looks like my job here is done. Goodbye, everyone! Thank you, Captain Hindsight!
Yeah, you know this person at work? That when things go bad, they say, oh, the color of this button should have been different. Oh, the copy is not good. The layout doesn't work. We knew it. We all know this person. We obviously never want to be this person, right? But actually, this thing can be very powerful if we do it before things go bad. And this leads me to my third and final habit, to assume failure and ask why. You know these moments where we are in a meeting room and everybody says, yeah, our next feature is the winning feature. We're gonna do that. We're gonna get investment. We're gonna get our clients. This is going to be the winning thing. But in this moment, you should have a red bulb in your head that's telling you, if there is no questions and no doubt, the mindset in this room is the certain mindset. And what you need to do in this moment is switch to an uncertain mindset by imagining you've already launched the feature and it just failed. What can be the reason why? Analyze backwards. What might be the reason why this feature can fail? Kind of like solving a maze from the end to the beginning. And this is something, it's very powerful, and I use it a lot, because it's something you can do in your head, and all of a sudden, questions come up and you ask them, and very experienced CEOs and entrepreneurs just become pale when you ask them those questions. Right? When you think, what do we want to solve? Is there a problem? Who is it for? Very basic stuff. So try to imagine, what if it fails? What might be the reasons why? You will all of a sudden see new details. You know, I've been conducting a series of workshops with a very successful e-commerce company. They already have an amazingly successful product, and over 10 months, we planned a redesign. And it was only when we reached the final sessions that I asked the team, imagine this redesign fails. What might be the reason why? And then the head of user experience came up and said that I think it might fail because the registration form is too long. Wow, silence in the room. Everybody was amazed and embarrassed. How come we've been so concentrated on what's inside? We didn't even realize that the door is almost locked. The registration form was 15 fields. So look how powerful this simple question is. This led us to think of new options. And we thought, okay, let's remove the registration form and let users come in and engage with the product seamlessly. And then we will ask them questions, small questions, as they engage and register their profile in the background. Okay, we even patented this. This became the best innovation for this redesign. And it came only at the end, only when we assumed failure and asked why. This is very simple and very powerful. When we feel confident, when we feel too certain, we fall asleep. Our brain is sleeping. We all the time want to feel the doubt, the questioning, and slightly embarrassed in order to for the brain to bring up its resources and stop conserving energy. So I'm starting to wrap up. You know, you might be using many tools. Each one, you can use the tool that you feel is comfortable for you. But don't forget to pay attention to how you feel when you work. Because how you feel drives what you think. What you think drives what you do. And what you do is who you are. So pay attention to how you are feeling. And the next time you feel this burn, uncomfortable burn of uncertainty, just remember one thing, that uncertainty is creativity. It's not an obstacle. Uncertainty is how creativity feels. Don't run away from it. Work with it. Now, I know it's not easy. This is hard, but if you would be brave enough to limit your superpower and to adopt mistakes and see the potential beauty along the way and to look ahead, transform yourself to the future, assume it fails and ask why, you have a true opportunity to make even more creative work. Thank you very much.